based in the Irish Centre for Human Rights. In a moment, I'm going to hand you over to Conor Fortune from Frontline Defenders, who's going to introduce our amazing speaker today. But just a couple of quick kind of housekeeping points. There are emergency exits at the back and one here on my right at the front. In terms of the running order, Parvin is going to speak for about 50 minutes, so we'll have about 30 minutes for Q&A at the end. I don't have a roving mic, so I would just say if you are asking a question, please speak kind of as loudly and clearly as you can, and try to keep your questions kind of fairly brief. Okay, but for now, I'm going to hand you over to Conor from Frontline Defenders. Thank you all so much for coming.
Thanks so much, Adele, and welcome everyone to the 2023 Frontline Defenders annual lecture tour, which is in partnership with obviously the University of Galway, but also Trinity College Dublin, University College Dublin, and Queen's University of Belfast. My name is Conor Fortune. I'm Head of Communications and Events at Frontline Defenders, and obviously we're in the Dillon Lecture Theatre today at the University of Galway. We'd like to say a special word of thanks to our partners here at the university, so Adele Hughes, also Siobhan Mullally, and Professor Ray Murphy at the Irish Centre for Human Rights, who were instrumental in helping with the collaboration to make today's event happen. Before I introduce you to this year's wonderful lecture, I'd just like to share some background about the annual lecture series itself and tell you a little bit about the work that Frontline Defenders does for human rights defenders, particularly in Iran, which is obviously the focus of today's lecture. So the annual Frontline Defenders lecture was established in 2013 to provoke discussion and debate about the range of issues facing human rights defenders who are at risk, especially as they work tirelessly to bring about changes and build robust civil societies in their countries. The lecture is meant to be broadly accessible to a general audience with an interest in philosophy, law, human rights, or politics. And previous lecturers have included the likes of Professor Noam Chomsky, Professor Martha Nussbaum, Dr. Sigrid Rousing, to name just but a few. For those of you who aren't familiar with the work of Frontline Defenders, the organization was founded in Dublin in 2001 with the specific aim of protecting human rights defenders at risk. And we define human rights defenders as anybody who works non-violently for any or all of the rights enshrined in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We work around the world and we address the protection needs identified by human rights defenders themselves. So we work very closely hand in hand with defenders in the countries where they face risk. Before I introduce the speaker today, I just wanted to mention the work that Frontline Defenders has been doing on the situation in Iran, in particular since last September, when protests gripped the country in the aftermath of the killing of a young woman, Masa Jina Amini, in police custody last September. Since then, Frontline has documented the arrest of over 200 Iranian human rights defenders. We've given digital protection advice to secure the Instagram, Twitter, Telegram, and WhatsApp accounts of over 60 detained Iranian activists who had their mobile devices confiscated by the authorities after taking part in protests. Frontline has been identifying and supporting emerging local civil society groups inside the country. And additionally, we've given around 20 protection grants to individuals for medical support, legal fees, temporary relocation, digital security, preventive measures, and family support. Now to introduce and warmly welcome our lecturer today, Parvin Ardalan. Parvin Ardalan is a feminist activist, journalist, and writer with a background in the grassroots feminist movement in Iran. She's currently a board member of Swedish PEN and a member of the network Feminist Virginia. She currently works at the Unit for Documentation and Freedom of Expression at Malmo City Archives. Her interest in gender, social movements, and migration led her to launch a process, jointly with civil society and numerous cultural institutions, to create Women Making Her Story, a project committed to the unveiling, visualizing, and rewriting the life and work of women in migration backgrounds in Sweden. It is my great honor today to welcome Parvin, and we're really looking forward to her lecture this afternoon, titled Jin Jian Azadi, Woman, Life, Freedom, A Social Vision for Human Dignity and Human Rights. Welcome, Parvin.
Thank you so much, Frontline University, that an audience that we have coming and for the invitation. And it's a great honor to be here and talk a little about feminists or Jinas. For feminist revolution or Jina revolution in the making. Before I start talking, I would like you watch a video, and then after that, I will start my talking. Shall I start? Jina uprising, or as I call it, the revolution in the making, has been analyzed from different perspectives. But here I would like to take a look to this from an intersectional standpoint. In my speech today, first of all, I describe this current revolutionary moment in Iran, how and why the governmental murder of Jina took us to this particular point. And after this, I will try to unpack the radical potential and meaning of Jin Jian Azadi, life, woman, freedom, or in Farsi, Om Zan Zendegi Azadi. The entangled relation of these three elements, woman, life, freedom, shows us that radical grassroots feminist movements are always concerned with transforming the everyday and ordinary conditions of life as a way of addressing the structural oppression. The attention to the ordinary necessities of life and always targets the most marginalized groups harder. is the lesson. Is the lesson for Jin Jian Azadi for the human rights movement as well. The governmental murder of Jina Amini in September 2022 sent the Iranian society into a revolutionary moment where woman has emerged as a symbol of discrimination and resistance at the intersection of all forms of discrimination. In this paradigm shift, the past and current protest movements are linked together through the celebrated slogan of Jin Jian Azadi, a new horizon of change has now opened in front of all of us. Only 7 months have passed since the murder of Jina Amini at the uproar after that, the Jina Revolution, or the revolution in making of women life freedom. But its enlightening impulses and the collapse of the walls fear of the patriarchal, centralist, nationalist, and sheer religious despotism have been thunderous. The revolution not only lives on despite repressions, killing, executions, blinding, poisoning of school girls, but also it reached every corner and even beyond the borders of Iran. Have you heard about Jina Revolution? Yes. And you know the last news was that poisoning the school girls. So it means that how this revolution is spreading out. The incident that, in the name of Jina, became the symbol of revolution, changed the fate of all of us through the intersectional approach. A revolution that begins from the most excluded, marginalized, and powerless social layers, a revolution that includes both protest and change. This revolution, grounded on new life-oriented for new life, social relation, and justice for everyone. Even though the revolution started as a protest against compulsory hijab, it has not remained limited to that. Where women are basically a symbol of discrimination, this is not only manifested in choosing the type of clothing, but also in access to the public spaces, job opportunity, family relationships, self-determination, society and cultural and right to the live with dignity has been denied to women. Jina's revolution movement was not first uprising in Iran, but a continuation of recent waves of uprising and protests in 2017, 2019, 2021, and 2022, as well as the ongoing protests of worker unions, bus drivers, and teachers' syndicates, and other protests that now is continuing every time in the cities. So I just wanted to say that this kind of protest is like an ongoing protest in Iran, and now this, you see that the distance between the any protest is decreasing. All these protests started. I put it for the time. I forgot. All these protests started for a different reason, but met each other at the intersection of Jina's revolution, a revolution that centered its demands on the gender issues. If you see, have you heard about this revolution, what happens? It was told that more than 2 million people were in other cities. It was more than 130 or 40 cities and local areas that they had a protest. And they were many different generations, from young generation and older one. But most of the people that you could see in this pictures, they are more young because they can be in front line of everything. But you see that, for example, women sitting in front of the policies to like a protest or resistance for. So this kind of revolution, why we say that revolution on the making, because it has been 7 months that has passed, but until now we see the different similar, different other voices every time coming up in different form. And the other things is that it started from marginalized form, marginalized cities, and then spread it in other parts of the cities. So this kind of format also was, they had some criticize about the number, because people thinking that, they said that is not a revolution because it's the number is not many. But the important thing is that in this form of revolution, we are talking about the horizontal revolutions, that quality is more than the quantity, because it has been involved many other people in the different cities, and also in the virtual area, and also in the national area. So why I am here is because of this kind of, the quality of this kind of revolution. Jina's revolutionary movement was, yes, sorry, I had to say. At this point, it is important that to mention about Wida Mubahed. As a, one of the women that she, in 2017, when we had different kind of protests, in 2017, before that also, we had different kind of protests about obligatory hijab. But most of the time, for example, people try to, women try to change the color, the change of the size of the dress code that they had, and also to show their reaction or criticizes in the writing form. But the, during the 2017, when there was a protest about the increasing the prices, Wida Mubahed went to under the top of the utility box, and then she take over her scarf and then put it in her hand. So it was something else that happened, some shifting in the women movement's protest form, because just asking from the the right of the choosing the dress code, it was that just like a freedom for the body. So for this reason, Wida Mubahed, it was one of the persons or that event that made this turning point. At this point, it was important to mention Wida Mubahed and her one woman protest against compulsory hijab in December 2017. One day amongst the days when people were protesting the increasing price of daily goods, Wida climbed from the utility box in Tehran and started waving her white headscarf like a flag tied to a stick. You see in the photos. By her spontaneous action, Wida elevated the protest to compulsory hijab into manifestation or a protesting body that also claimed the right to be present in a masculine public space on her own terms. So still, what happens that gender protests became to so widespread in Iran? Jina, 22 years old, Kurdish girl, was murdered in Tehran. The hijab enforcing police, or morality police they mentioned, arrested her on 13th of September. 3 days later, 16th of September, she died in the hospital. The news of Jina's death immediately triggered protests in Iranian Kurdistan. Kurdistan, ever since the birth of this Islamic Republic in 1979, has hosted many political movements in opposition to the Islamic regime. Therefore, Kurdistan has been subjected to particularly harsh repression from the beginning. However, the protests did not remain limited to Kurdistan. The Kurdish slogan, Jin Jian Azadi, Woman Life Freedom, has been picked up and shouted in protests around Iran. زن زندگی آزادی. Within 2 months after Jina's murder, the hashtag Mahsa Amini or Jina Amini, along with slogan Jin Jian Azadi, has been used over 300 million times. This shows how fast the protests spread across the country. They eventually led to the most widespread and longest protest in the life of Islamic Republic. Of course, at this moment, at this point, we would not that prior to the murder of Jina. There was an ongoing accumulation of demands and dissatisfaction over the years. It was predictable to see these demands exploded at the same point, at the same point. The beautiful thing is that the turning point for this explosion of demand was the intersection of various economic, religious, and national demands with the demand for end of gender oppression at the center of gravity that held the whole protest together. So why women's rights became the center of gravity, and why now? The history of women's struggle in Iran goes back more than 100 years, a period that always been accompanied by ups and downs, repression and resistance, interference in national affairs, a struggle for the presence and acquisition of political and civil rights, a struggle for women's authority over their bodies, a struggle against being unveiled and forced veiling, a force to educate and raise women's awareness, organizing protests, forming associations and groups, establishing girls' school, efforts to win admission of university, launching various magazines, solidarity with national and transnational movement, and so on. This has been the agenda of Iranian feminist movement for the last century. Despite the dominant gender-focused socioeconomic, cultural, and religious structure, and the overall discriminatory conditions of the Islamic regime, the women in Iran have individually and collectively, on a daily basis, resist against repression, suppression, and oppressions throughout the post-revolution by using various methods of resistance. When women and men stood shoulder to shoulder during the Iranian Revolution 1979, one of the main elementary slogans and demands changed by the protesters during the Iranian Revolution was bread, home, freedom. The Iranian Revolution was rapidly overtaken and established as an unchallenged Islamic Republic for a referendum. According to the rules and tradition of Islam, all women, and Islamic, that the Islam, then the Shia Islam by Iranian regime. According to the rules of and tradition of this regime, men and women were considered free and equal. But under constraining laws of Sharia and Islamic Shia discourse, in which everything must be Islamic, as proclaimed by Khomeini, the religious leader of Iranian regime. It was after days after the revolution. Viewing women as provocative sexual objects in need of male dominance and control was at the center of the gender policy of Islamic State. Emphasize on the overlap between religion and politics and establishing a Sharia-governed juridical system, separating public and private space for women, was the starting point for the new regime in 1979. Forced veil and repeal of the Family Protection Act were the first signs of the turnover change. Some of the main backwards-looking changes in this period were the limiting right of custody and guardianship over a child for mothers, right to housing facilitating polygamy, and limiting women's right to divorce and removing of prohibition of child marriage. There are just some examples. In this period, women as a collective mass were defined as dutiful Muslim women and were used as a political force, but had no political role in decision making, and were by default eliminated in the ideological male dominant construct. Thus, restriction and violence against women's rights and freedom were said to be one of the main pillars of the regime. It should not be a surprise that the first group to protest in the early days after the Islamic Revolution were the women who rallied to the on the street on 8th of March 1979. The protest was suppressed, and more radical bans such as dismissal from male-dominated occupations, exclusion from workplaces, sexual segregation in the educational system were put in place to exclude women from the public sphere and to have total control of women's morality. It is in this context that we can understand the form of early days, the control of women, people with gendered identities and sexual orientations became a cornerstone of this patriarchal centralist Islamic regime. The current struggle does not necessarily come from to the old forms, although it is indebted to previous feminist struggle. The Jina revolution is a leap over the beyond them, a change on the level of a struggle, a transformation in paradigm. This is entering another phase of history where everything is transformed and changed, even ourselves within the women's movement in Iran. This is a movement from below that heart of the political state and other patriarchal institutions of power. It is the concrete symbol of the personal political and the symbol of moving from asserting demands to a collective action for a structural change. The active and participatory presence in all relations of power, a dynamic movement which creates various non-linear situations full of permanent reflections while moving forward. The emancipatory aspects of this revolutionary uprising include the categorical rejection of any form of any kind of despotism, violence, and emancipation from exploitation in all political, social, economic, and environmental aspects. A clear example that shows how Jina revolution is a new, irrevisible chapter in the history of feminist movement is the movement of mother seeking justice, or Badarane Dadkhwah in Persian, and the families of those who were murdered, who sorry. The modern resistance started after 1979, after the Iranian, during the Iranian-Iraq war. There were very, most of the women were, most of the political oppositions, they were killed at that period. And this demand that from the, and nobody could find them, and it, if this mother were not exist, nobody could know that many people were killed. And this tradition from the beginning of the revolution until now is continuing. And one of these mothers, as an example, is Daye Sharife. Daye Sharife is a mother of Ramin Hossein Panahi. Ramin was a Kurdish activist. The Islamic Republic executed Ramin in 2018. The heartfelt protest and request of Daye Sharife to stop the execution of her son has remained in our collective memory. After the execution of Ramin, Daye Sharife has always appeared in public sense carrying her son's photo, like many mothers whose children have been killed by the regime. In 2021, 3 years after governmental murder of her son, Daye Sharife appears in another photo. This time her son's photo hang on a wall behind her. You see in the photos. In her hand, Daye Sharife held a banner that read, "Stop killing Kurdish Kulbars, Baluchi fuel smugglers and the thirsty Arabs of Khuzestan." It has written, "We suffer a common pain. My heart is with you in the streets, my children." After the murder of Jina, Daye Sharife held another sign. They took Jina's life in the capital city and in the borderland. "My son Ramin, my daughter Jina." Daye Sharife is one example of many of Madarane Dadkha, who every day continue their mourning and justice seeking for meeting with other mothers from different national identities or religious groups. They continue to not only inspire the population with their courage, but also show how Jina's revolution is a revolution about entanglement of all our individual, national, gender, religious, and cultural suffering. The example of Madarane Dadkha shows how mourning of a loved one gradually became a public issue, a life-affirming action that one by one politicized the individual bodies across all national boundaries. The example of Daye Sharife is a specific show how those standing at the intersection of all hierarchical of oppression can start to make visible bodies that were rendered invisible because of various multiple oppressive relations of force. The story of Daye Sharife is the story of invisibility of many people, that they are under the different layer and they have been forbidden. A week ago, and during the Iranian New Year, Nowruz, Daye Sharife held another sign, this time congratulating Nowruz and highlighting the revolutionary slogan, "Jin Jian Azadi." What is the meaning of women, life, freedom, Jin Jian Azadi? when they carried the Jina's body to Kurdistan, the mourning people gathered around Jina's grave started to shout, "Murder for a headscarf. We no longer accept this humiliation." Women took off the tooth of their headscarf, waved them in the air, and shouted, "Jin Jian Azadi," woman life freedom. This sharp, timely, and emancipatory action was not a simultaneous reaction. This slogan is rooted in the tradition of resistance among Kurdistan women of Bakur in Turkey. Woman life freedom was reborn in Sakes in Iran, Kurdistan in Iran, the hometown of Jina, to become the voice of protest against gender and sexual oppression in Iran. This slogan mixed with other forms of protest like cutting hair, removing headscarf, dancing in the public, screaming and standing on top of utility boxes. Women took back the public space and action that were formerly presented as masculine. Somaye Rostampour, PhD researcher in sociology at Paris 8, she reminds us that women of Bakur, those who shaped this slogan, were successful because they expanded their focus beyond traditional boundaries of the resistance movement. These women went beyond national, geographical, and political divisions and tried to connect their action to women from different social classes and cultures. The traditional success and appeal of this slogan is owed to the efforts of women of Bakur. This slogan carries the message of life as a central content. When women shouted this slogan and danced instead of mourning, according to Somaye, they transformed the masculine public spaces in a feminine spaces. The simplicity of this slogan and yet its rich content, along with actions such as signing and dancing, singing and dancing that usually accompanies it, seems to be the point of connection between resistance movement from all across the world against all forms of patriarchal domination. This slogan reminds us that the fight against patriarchy is connected to fighting against gender, national, racial, and class oppression. It insists on the entanglement of freedom with gender issues and a standard of life for all. If we do not fight against all forms of structural suffering now, it is very possible that our freedom comes at the cost of unfreedom of other people. The future is now, and we cannot postpone any fight to an unknown future. There is no priority in fight against oppression and suffering. The centrality of gender oppression in this slogan is to point out that we need to start from the bottom of the intersection of all the suffering in order to be able to fight for all intersecting causes. This is fight from below to top. So woman life freedom, in other words, puts its finger on a structural and radical change to all of the conditions of our collective and individual sufferings. The important question is now how to achieve this big goal. Achieving such a fundamental change that transforms conditions of unfreedom for all discriminated groups requires the engagement of people from all the layers of oppression. This means that the critical issue for us is to organize and act from below. Woman, life, freedom, or structural change is not possible with the rush for finding top-down alternative. Such as approach contradicts women, life, freedom, and maintain the patriarchal structures. Woman, life, freedom is a form of a struggle that is based in grassroots action. When people engage in building alternatives themselves, they claim the movement from them for themselves and expand it. A clear example of this movement, as I told you, is a form of Daya Sharife and other mothers. Highlighting the grassroots historical and political struggle of the Middle Eastern women should put an end to the ongoing orientalist impulses of some of the Western human rights movements in imagining alternatives for the Middle East and from above. The lesson that the human rights movement can learn from Jin Jian Azadi is the recognition and a return to the radical grassroots practices. As Angela Davis once put it, in the process of becoming a mainstream, we should not forget the movement itself. It is only when the political horizon is created by the people themselves that they fight for it and protect it. Today, some efforts in the human rights movements are centralized on creating alternatives from above, and making the fight into the projects can mobilize to help hungry, shelter refugees, or protect the war victims. But it's rarely can speak about why hunger is made possible in the first place, what conditions make it unlivable for people, and why wars happen. We need the protesting about them also, against them. A return to the ordinary and the everyday needs of people for life, as well as recognition of a radical function of the grassroots movement, is the greatest achievement of Jin Jian Azadi for today's human rights movement, not only Iran, but also around the world. In the beginning of this talk, I showed a video. This was one of the first songs of the revolution, known as Ballad of Leylas. This song is written by an activist of Iranian feminist movement who intentionally remained anonymous. Can I put it just when I'm talking? Thank you so much. Without voices, thanks. This song is important because it captures the intersection of all oppression. It is a song that has overcome the temporality of all the suffering among different national and gendered groups. It layers oppressions in different times and geography upon each other and provides a unique but plural picture of marginalized voices and bodies. In this way, the song works against the pluralization from the top and creates voices of solidarity from below. The title of this song is inspired from a letter of a Kurdish teacher, Farzad Kamangar, who was executed in 2006. This song travels across the past and present of Islamic oppression and pictures a future where all the ordinary needs and all the forbidden voices find their place. From Gina's hair to Sarina's shoes, to Afghan refugees, to the struggle against war and fight against isolation and marginalization of Baluchistan, this song captured the idea of Jin Jian Azadi. This is, if there is going to be a change, in it can happen by coming together of all the marginalized body. As the song quotes Farrukh Farrukhzad in this year also, the savior is in the mirror. Nothing is like before after murdering Jina Amini. Another world is in the making, and we believe that future is now. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Sorry,
Parvin.
I did it was long.
No,
I tried to make
no,
it shorter.
We're right on time. We have plenty of time for questions and answers. If anybody has a question, please raise your hand.
I'm from Libya, and you talk about revolution, and we have revolution in Libya in 2011, and as you mentioned here, protest, like, do you think this is, can change Iranian government, who's very strong government, like, you know, and they have history for fighting against Iraq for 8 years, or for many things like this. Do you think this revolution can change anything in your government? Because I see the scenario in Libya, the revolution like killed many people, but after that, when the people start fighting with weapons and everything, it's coming like in 8 months and everything like get that done, because we have a very similar dictatorship, like the same system. But do you think this is more like killing people, and this can help later and to change the government, not as a system, but change something inside the government, make new rules for women, and support it, the women, or change all this very strong system, which we know, like, if it collapses the system, can make it worse later? What do you think about this, you know? I'm not sure about the Iranian system, how it's built, but I know about Libyan system, which collapses everything, destroyed it, after that, and we come to 12 years with the civil war in Libya. But do you think new generation in Iran can change and they replace the system in the strong system? And I have another question about headscarf. You mentioned about women wearing headscarf, and we know this is not only mandatory in, it's mandatory in your country and not in another country, which become more flexible, and we can see the example in Saudi Arabia, which they change the way now women can drive. Maybe later they will not, they take the headscarf. But do you think it's just not only in Iran? They control, it's men controlling women by let them, like, for, like, ask them, do they have to wear the headscarf? But we know that's not only the religion part.
Yes.
And we know it's like Islam can make women, okay, this is your way. But do you think it's not only for religion part, it's for men controlling women? What do you think about this?
Yes, many questions.
I'm so sorry. I would like to
hopefully I remember what answer. No, I'm just thinking that, so we know that this Iranian dictatorship, they have used many different tools for controlling everybody. But they started with the controlling women's body, and then it developed to other places. What I see that in these years, of course, the feminist movements in Iran has tried to make many changes, but not make radical changes maybe. We started from to like a witnessing, and then to criticizing, and trying to reforming, and then also to acting. some changes, like the woman 1 million signature campaign that we started. It was to change the law, not to correct, to reforming the law. It was changing completely and radical changes. But also is developed to other changes that are changing in the equal, not only equal right, but also equality. So it was developed every time in the women movement, many different concepts and discourses. And this time what happens, I think that it was more, not it started with gender, but it's now spread in everywhere. So but what is the start point was the gender, and then it's kind of that the gender was a symbol of discrimination and still is a, it was the core of discrimination that exists still. So if you wanted to look at these changes, so we need to make it this, to use this feminist policy with this the feminist point of view to change everything. So in this way it would be democratization form, not just to rechange the government or state. It means that doing a horizontal form for the changing. So it, and then make a changing in the social values, in the social thoughts, in the different behaviors, in everything, in the different form. So in this way, I think this revolution is successful. And also the legitimacy of the Iranian regime, now not there is not no more. No more, it doesn't mean that I think is that no more. It means that when you see them, when you people don't afraid, and then they show their braveness and in every in any form, so it means that they have passed this form. Before, for a long time, we've been discussing about the hijab, also obligatory hijab. So we had so much debate about this is not a problem, it's not an issue. So we have to think about another issue. Of course, when we talked also, it was very difficult to talk about that because it was not the meaning of a scarf, it's the meaning of the symbol of the showing a country that is an Islamic country. And for Iran, this was important. So if you wanted to change the symbol, so it means that you are damaging this image. So for this reason, until now, they try to resist and try to oppress people for this thing. But now, not anymore. Nowadays, they have increased a lot of rules for controlling the women's body. But people, what women are coming to the street without any hijab, and then they try to just change this condition. So I think that in this way, it started with the obligatory hijab, but now gradually women that are going to change this. And this time is not just only a woman's issue, something that made the changes. Because before, if something happened, the men tried to help or they were watching something like that. But now you see that the death of the murdering of Jina is the core of the discrimination, other different kind of discrimination. So if something happens, so it means that everybody is under the result is for everybody. So it means that in this way it's not my issue or your issue, it's the issue for everybody. So I think these things, that this knowledge that is made, that this kind of revolution are creating the knowledge of the revolution in itself and change the discourses for make a structural changing. So I think these are very important things that nowadays we will see in the society. And the other question was,
I think you've partly addressed it because it was in relation to the wearing of the hijab. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, and also it's not exactly, you know, there are many different discussion about that. For example, in Sweden, many of the protesters and the left groups or also the feminist groups, they didn't know how should I support this movement. Is it what are you doing? Is it like Islamophobia things or not? So it is some kind of discussion like that around this. But it's not Islamophobia or something like that. It, of course, it's criticizing the religion with this way. But it doesn't mean that when you are burning a scarf, you are using burning a different religion. we have Baha'is religion that they are under the pressure. So we are talking about the freedom of religion also for Baha'is. So it means that something that when the religion come to the power and they try to control everything, so it's the bullshit. So we have to change it.
For your very, very informative and impressive presentation. My name is Nilufar Omidi. I am a human rights researcher and activist in Galway. And when you had a call on social media on 2nd of October and named the name Jina and asked us to have protest, Anahit Aniastert, one of activists in Galway, and I, we organized a protest in Galway, and it was really good, and we saw that how people, and even Irish people, were very interested and they attended. And I am very happy that today we have you here. My question is about the revolution that it is actually ongoing, and it gave us hope after many years, and it is, as you mentioned, it is completely different from other movements during these four decades. But one thing is very, very worrying, that I am worried that now people are sacrificing their lives. But I am worried that monarchists and opportunists would hijack this revolution. What is your opinion about this?
Actually, when I talk about the structuring from below, so it means that I'm opposite of this criticizing this kind of form. But it depends on the when it's happening. You know, when you are talking about the democratic society, then every group and every parties, every opinions have the equal situation that they can come, and then they try to think about how should we make a new the future of Iran, so it's something else. But if you think that, okay, this is the first alternative for us, just bring somebody, no matter is the good or bad guy, or a good shah or not good king or not bad king. The important is that how. I think that important for us in this learning to this Jin Jian Azadi's slogan is that how we are going to achieve something, not what is the things that we wanted to achieve. And if you think about the how, so then it shows that if you wanted to go from the below, so it means that we have to follow the form of these activities. People came from different local area, and then they organized, and then they produced their literature, their stories, and then every voices. So then we carried that one, and then this goes bigger and bigger. So nowadays we need to create this kind of discourse and from below and discuss about that, not to find an alternative. And the problem of the revolution was that since everything has happened, come together, everybody in the street, and the street is a very important thing, that we nowadays we should discuss about that. Why very street people are changing, women are changing again the street, and they try to take it back. These are the most important discourses that we should discuss. But the problem is that when some kind of demonstration happen, and people from outside, not exactly most of the time inside, they see and then say, oh, this is the time for regime change. Okay, but then it would be to bring many people, many like foreign friends, they were thinking, oh, again, you're talking about regime change, and again, nothing will happen. I said, yes, because some of people are surprised, and then they think that, oh, we need an alternative, and we need to put it there. So for this reason, I'm just thinking that the important thing is that how we are taking a look to this feminist revolution. And if you think about that, okay, next month we will be have another regime, and then which kind of alternative we can come and from up. So then we have to look at the government, different countries, how we should do that. But look at the reality. In the reality, there were people that they supported the movement in around the world, and from the different movements, syndicates or unions, and feminist groups, artists, activists, everywhere. And then at the end, we saw that the government should took the reaction and tried to support people. So if we wanted to go this way, we have to encourage different movements in different cities and encourage them to push their government, but not to ask government to push the Iranian regime. Thank you. Yes.
Thanks so much. I wanted to say, I think I've noticed, I'm sure maybe Farhaz too, and also on social media, which is within Ireland a huge platform for information, has been, I'm sure it's the same for you in your networks, that solution of sort of social media influencers, many of them in the diaspora, like I grew up in the States, you know, comedians, actors, actresses of Iranian heritage who are really putting forward this, the groups that we know who we're talking about, but promoting that, and I think a lot of our Irish friends who are in Ireland are looking that at that as a solution. And that, so I would wonder too, how can Irish people who are here today or people who are living in Ireland support our movement for justice in Iran on the streets today? What sorts of,
I think we have to internalize this concept, because as we receive this slogan from Kurdistan in Turkey, and then now spread it in other cities in Iran, and now it's going to move in another country. In Sweden, we had a lot of program about under this title about the movements. So it's not just exactly about Iran. So I just wanted to say that this is the concept that we need for using as a solidarity voice and to make a connection between each other. Many feminist movements can transform this slogan for the current situation that happens for different marginalized groups, as also women here in different countries. So if we internalize something and to adapt it to our voices, so then they don't come just to defend women movement in Iran or their protest in Iran. Everybody come and to defend these values and try to promote and to make it as a content of this movement. And this way, I think we will be more stronger. But it would be difficult, of course. We need to have more transnational communication, discussion, and to find different kind of solution for preservation in this context. And unfortunately, this time, we are facing in a different form of this in different countries. Fascism is coming, racism is coming, and you know, everything fundamentalism is coming, so then we are living with them. So we have to change many things. And it's unfortunately it's very difficult nowadays when you are discussing, everything is not clear to find out what is right and what is wrong. And sometimes you see somebody say that I'm a democratic person, but they are talking about the no liberalization, or they are talking about the human rights, but how you can make a connection between them. So it's a question of how. And then this is the make us clear that who we can work together and who we can solidarity with each other today. And then it comes to the question of the solidarity. Most of the time, the solidarity is the meaning of helping. It's not just helping. Solidarity is that to find a way that to make a more stronger civil society in a different aspect.
Any other questions or comments?
What do you think about this Jina revolution? What made you to come here?
You talk about Iranian women. What they are facing there in Iran? It's just only scarf or like gender equality in the work, or you have arranged marriage. Like what they facing there, Iranian women in Iran? What rules make it control like the woman? Scarf or arranged marriage or work in the public space or what else we don't know like about Iran?
I just explained in my talk some part of it, because it's a different way. The controlling of the body is very important. Now after Jina revolution, we say that we talk about the freedom of the bodies, not exactly freedom of the hijab. So it means that when you're controlling everything, so it means that how you are act in the public spaces and how do you act in the private space. And for this reason, we are talking about the private is political, because everything is connected with that one. So it comes to the legal situation for women and men, that according to the Sharia law, so we have more problem for women in a different form that I mentioned. In the situation of work, of course, women can work, but we have the men, some men-dominated jobs, so some of the works women cannot do, but of course they do. This is the resistance of that. And then we have many, the discrimination is a different layers, and we cannot, and also when it comes to the ethnical issue, we have another problem. When it comes to the class issue, we have another problem. So we have not just, but the whole of the idea is that when it comes to the gender issue, and it's not just only women, LGBTQs and like queer groups, and when it comes to the gender, so there are more discrimination in different forms. Because you have to adapt yourself with the frame of man, and then after, and a Muslim man and Shia. So it's, you see that there are many things that you have to be in this frame. So otherwise, then you shouldn't do that.
Okay, if I just build on point.
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah, I just think as Parvin said, and this you were talking about. Iranians have forever, we've been trying to reform the Islamic Republic, and it's been 43 years since 1979. We've had originally started off the chador, the full covering that women had to wear, and then they protested it so they could wear the hijab. So they've started already. We've tried reforming it, but it doesn't work. Because, you know, you gain one step and you have to take five steps back. Like, there's people in the women, whether it be Persians, Kurds, Arabs, Azeri, everybody for the first time is protesting together. And the Khomeini, Ayatollah Khomeini, the original Supreme Leader, his house in his town is getting burned. So there's no going back. Like, the revolution is happening, and it's already happened. There's no more time for reform. What happened in Libya with Gaddafi is horrible, but I think with Iran, it's not very, it's like...
But wasn't in the beginning, like, we talked in the beginning, in 2011, when we go to street, we're looking for human rights, we're looking for freedom, and in the Libya scenario, a little bit different, I'm sure, from Iran. But we start first, the same way. We go to the street, we ask for freedom, we ask for human rights, we ask for equality, for everything. Like, but after that, the scenario completely changed, and we stuck after that 12 years in the civil war. We finished from Gaddafi, which was dictatorship, which is similar to the dictator you have in Iran, which controlling and the war in Iraq for 8 years, and again they have a problem with Saudi Arabia for many years, and now they now try to build this relationship between Iraq and between Saudi Arabia and Iran again, mm-hmm. which I don't know, it's just political system they lay around. But in the meantime, we have now, in the 12 years in Libya, many women killed. They are doctors, nurses, and they are, thus, after all of this, lost a lot of women in Libya. Now I'm afraid to go back. There's doctors that Kurdish killed. Some of my friends, like, they stopped working. So it is more about women in Libya, and also in, we can see in Iran, they killed a lot of women after this revolution, like, so the victims in the end are mostly women. Yes, there is mass about this, but do you think this is, as I understand now, because I don't understand many things about Iran, the system need to change the rules or the law in Iran to involve more women rights. But in my country, it wasn't like this scenario. We are looking to change all the system after 8 months from the war in Libya. So. I find it is like little bit different scenario. In the meantime, it's getting worse in Libya. So how do you see Iran after 10 years from now? Because in the beginning, we see the same image. Everything will be fine. We'll have a freedom. We will have the riot. Women can have riot. But now we have, yes, we read out from the system. Gaddafi was destroyed everything after he's gone. Like the system was around him. but we are more afraid than before.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think this is in Iran? The people, after controlling and change, the new generation can handle a new way or a new Iran? Because Libya couldn't handle it.
Mm-hmm.
Because we don't have many educated in the system.
Mm-hmm.
And after we change the Gaddafi system, we stuck with many dictatorship in Libya. So I don't know, like, how do you see Iran after 10 years?
Mm-hmm.
And do you think this is, I had this image in Libya, 2011, I was there. I was on the street, asked for changing, but I regret it after many years, because now it's getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
We stuck in the civil war, and we lost many female, like, working everywhere. It's not safe to go without scarf. You cover even your face, you are not safe.
Mm-hmm.
So, we don't, in my country, Libya, the health scarf is not obligatory, so you can
mm-hmm.
wear it or no. But now, you have to wear it, otherwise you will kill.
Mm-hmm.
Getting worse, but what do you think about Iran
mm-hmm.
after 10 years from now?
Mm-hmm.
What
do you think?
Well, I think Libya and Iran are similar, but also very different at the same time. Like Gaddafi, in comparison to the Ayatollahs, is very different because they are Ayatollahs. They're like, we have like religious leaders that like in our government, whereas Gaddafi, of course, had his ideas about religion, but he wasn't an Ayatollah.
No, it wasn't strong with religion, but...
Yes, well, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
So, you know, we, again, 43 years, like we've... This is for me, I don't speak for all Iranians, never mind the Iranian women, but in my opinion, if you look at the economic situation in Iran, okay, you're asking what can happen in 10 years. If it keeps going the way it's going to happen in 10 years, where people can't buy bread, can't, you know, the river in Esfahan is dried up, people don't have water, right? So, the way I see it is, if we either do something soon, or it gets ran into the ground anyway. Because Ayatollahs have foreign private companies that they're building bridges and dams for that have no use whatsoever for the Iranian people, but just for the sake of filling quotas and getting paid for doing things like that. You look at the children of the Ayatollahs, they live in Switzerland and
yes.
France in these big houses and cars.
You still get
the people. Yeah, you know, so the way I see it is either 10 years, the country's in the ground, and you know, nothing is good anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Or we try for the second time to have a revolution, which is, I will say, very different to the revolution in 1979. Very, very, very different. You know, either we try again, and hopefully, in my opinion, it will eventually succeed, or the country gets run into the ground anyway. I don't really see a different option. In that, because it's unbearable to live there with how it is now, and like I said before, it won't go. The whole idea that, like, even Khamenei said that he's going to abolish the morality police. So what if he abolishes the morality police? The system is still there. I don't buy the whole like reforms over 5 years. No, they've lied for 43 years. I'm not just going to keep accepting the same lies, and it's willful and ignorance at that point. Like, you know what's going to happen.
And I think like you, and I think that as I told you, that something that changed after Jina's revolution, and we say that the Iran has not any legitimized, so it means that it's like an authority that has lost the power. So how do you want it to achieve it? So you are increasing your power through oppression. So the militarization of the country will be maybe, and they're getting so much support from Russia, China. So it means that, and also there are many geopolitical reasons. So we don't know really what happened in next 10 years, because there are many factors that they have. That not just every country like Libya. It was not happening in Libya, not was not
oh,
in.
Yeah,
it was something that a lot of intervention, peaceful intervention, made this Libya like that. So I just wanted to say that the important things is that what had happened inside, internal form, is changing because of the losing the this. You know, after every time of the protest, people were talking about Allahu Akbar. So it's like a slogan that God is great. is this okay for Muslims? But it was like a protest, a slogan of the protest. But this time it's just only one of the, I think, one of the cities they mentioned it. Because it was a secularization of the slogans, another four. And also the religion didn't have so much power this time. And these are something that is dangerous for the authority of Iran, because they have made all of the pillars on this four to put people under the many things. You know, after the Iranian-Iraq war, so people were, yes, we know what happens, but it was one of the important things for the Iranian regime, because they could make it as a war for Islam, dying for God, and the values of the women, Muslim values, why hijab is more important. So now everything they took from the people with this making this valuable form of the war. So, but now they are disappearing. Everything disappearing. And this, the educational form, they started from the revolution to make it something until the Islamic form that Khomeini wanted. But now you will see the primary school girls come to the street and shout against Khomeini, the leader of Iran. So it means that they couldn't be successful. So it's something that is like we have a corruption inside of in Iran, but there is a collapse in whole of the country about the authority. So this kind we cannot give it back again, change it. So I think this change is a very important thing as a radical change. But it doesn't take maybe 1 month. As much as we go and then we can, it's like a snowball. So it's coming and gradually add more things with each other. And in this way we have to discuss more, we have to more this debate also transnational form. We have to discuss about Libya, we have to discuss about what's happening there. And we have to make a connection with this thing. It's not an Iranian issue, it's the most important issue. So what we made us to be unite, what we made us to talk and to discuss about that, to change this situation. And another thing is that, as I told that in the intersectional form, we cannot prioritize which one is the first, because in after Iranian revolution, most of the people were silent, so just women later, children wait later. Everything that was later now is coming up, because it shows that nothing has been in later. Everything are at the same time. So we have to fight for everything at the same time. Otherwise we cannot. We don't. And so for this reason, I'm just thinking that the feminist intervention is very important. Feminist is not women. It's just who are the discussion, the discourse of this form that started from the critic from the beginning, and to change the situation, look at the marginal part, to change to the different things. So it means that how we are going to make these changes. And for this reason, I'm just thinking that the important thing is that from below, but it's very difficult, but of course we know. You know, in the slogan, Woman, Life, Freedom, after there is a song that it was very popular and very beautiful, Baraye, it means four. But in one part of it that it was, the singer was collected from the tweeters of the peoples. One phrase was that man, nation, development. And then at the same time, as you mentioned, we tried to shouting this slogan, and this slogan came at just opposite of that. When we say woman, life, freedom, so we should say man, nation and freedom, nation and development. So you have to just show your reaction about this. Otherwise, it happens what happened in Libya, what happens in Iran in 1979. So we have to rethink, and rethinking and making some changes, it is important. And now I think that the knowledge of the many women, many feminists, many human rights activists, thoughtful things, that now is a time that we have to bring them together and to discuss about them together. Because it's the only tools that we have. The tools of the governments is their own tools. But we have to have these tools as important point, important tools that we can use it. And for this reason, I'm just thinking that intervention is very important, but collective intervention is very important. And feminist point of view is very important. And we have to have this standpoint for every level of the activities.
Great. We have just a few minutes left. Did you want to say something? No. Okay. So if there are any final questions or comments, I know this is Pirvan's third lecture in 3 days.
Yes.
I'm also conscious that you might be happy to end 5 minutes early.
Sorry, I was a bit tired today because
well,
trying to.
It was fantastic.
When it was recording for me, it was stressful. I think you are recording these tingles.
Okay, well, if there are no further questions or comments, I would just like to really sincerely thank you, Pirvan, for making the trip to Galway. Sorry the rain didn't stay away for you, but. As I said earlier, it's a more authentic experience when you come to Galway and it rains. So, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming for time. And the Friday time, I told you that how people can stay here for boarding discussion on the Friday afternoon. So, so it means that thank you so much for this time that you gave us, gave me. And I consider it as a love. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.